So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So guys, as most of you would be knowing that in this series, we try to discuss some concepts which are related to finance and economics current affairs, and they can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams. So guys, as you all know that this is a 5-question series, and before we move ahead to question number 1, let me give you a little introduction about your mentor. So guys, I have done my graduation from Shri Guru Gobind Singh College of Commerce from University of Delhi, and I have done my post graduation from Delhi School of Economics, University of Delhi too, and after that I have cleared JRF in commerce as well as management, right? So that was a brief introduction. So are you ready for question number 1? And before moving to question number 1 for today, let me do the customary thing and ask you to subscribe to our channel. So guys, if you are watching our video for the very first time, then do hit the subscribe button. It can help you to stay in touch with us. And this bell icon can help you to know about different videos that come up regularly on our channel, right? And after that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. So this is our doubt solving mechanism. After that, here is your question number 1 for today. Okay, let's see, what does it talk about? It says, select the correct statement about paradox of thrift. So very simple question, 5 statements given to you, you have to select the correct one out of it. Moving ahead to the solution. So the correct option for this question is option E. That means paradox of thrift says proper response to an economic recession is more spending. So guys, first of all, let us understand this concept which is called paradox of thrift. So what is the meaning of this word thrift? So let's say you are a shopaholic and you really like to shop a lot. So your parents, they usually ask you to be a little more thrifty in your spending, right? So that means they want you to spend judiciously. They don't want you to be spending on irrelevant things or buying lots of clothes or shoes, right? So thrift means saving, spending judiciously, and after that saving. So why is saving a paradox? So saving is considered a good thing, right? And that too, if you belong to a country like India, where people are financially not very aggressive, or they do not have much financial appetite, being thrifty or doing savings is considered as a very good habit, right? Ask this to your parents, they will tell you the importance of savings, right? But now, why is it called a paradox here? See, it is being called a paradox because savings might be good for us on an individual level, but they are not good if your country, if your economy is going through a recession, then as for a nation as a whole or for an economy, in macro terms, saving is not a very good thing, because if you want to kickstart the economy needs you to spend, right? So if you want to shop and you want to buy some new clothes and shoes, so just ask your parents that my country needs it, right? So after that, you can see here, so paradox says economic theory, which argues that personal savings can be detrimental to overall economic growth. So we usually talk about how we need to generate demand in the economy to stimulate economic growth. And you see, RBI has been on a continuous spree to cut rates and to provide more and more liquidity so that people spend, right? And if people spend, if I am buying something, that is leading to income creation for someone. Now, if someone earns an income, that person is going to spend it somewhere, right? So this is a chain that forms and it multiplies. So the number of hands through which money passes, it provides income to those intermediaries, right? That is why spending is considered important on a macro level. So savings are good for individuals but not for economy as a whole. That is what this paradox of thrift states, right? I hope you are clear with the concept. So based on a circular flow of economy in which current spending drives the future spending, right? So if you spend now, then that money will multiply and that will determine that what is going to be the purchasing power or what is going to be the spending rate in future, because current spending will drive the economy or will kickstart the economy, leading to future spending. After that, it calls for a lowering of interest rates. So calls for lower interest rates so that cost of borrowing is less. So I think we have discussed it so many times that lowering of interest rates that leads to lower cost of borrowing, because see, the interest rates or the policy rates that are decided by the central bank of the country, they are like some benchmark rates which forms the basis of almost all the lending and borrowing agreements in the economy. That is why if a central bank cuts rate, it means they are trying to lower the cost of borrowing, or they want people to borrow more so that they can spend more, right? Simple concepts. So theory states an increase in current spending drives future spending. Current spending after all results in more income for current producers. So people who are into manufacturing or people who are producing, if you buy their stuff, that results in an income for them. Producers rationally deploy their, so see here in this last box, you can see the chain which leads to income creation. You are buying something, producer is getting income. That producer is going to put that money to some good use or deploy their new income into expanding their business or producing more. Sometimes expanding business and hiring new workers. So when they expand their business, in order to fulfill the increasing demand, they hire new workers. And these new workers then earn, and obviously if they earn, they spend, leading to more spending. So do you see how current spending here drives future spending, right? So moving ahead, before moving to question number 2, have a look at this cartoon, right? Moving ahead to question number 2. Okay. Here is question number 2, which says RBI recently allowed dash to co-originate priority loans with banks, which so far were restricted to non-banking finance companies. Very simple question. It was in news lately. The correct option for this question is option B. Option B means housing finance companies. So guys, this word here is important. Co-origination of loans. So this is a co-lending model. Here we are going to talk about a co-lending model. So you can understand from the name itself that some parties, they are going to come and lend together in a combined form. So that is known as co-lending. In simple terms, when we talk about it generally, when we say when some new type of lenders, they combine with traditional lenders like bank and they both work together, that model is known as a co-lending model. Now see, as you know, we just talked that RBI is trying to stimulate demand in the economy. They are trying to boost lending activity so that people borrow and spend. So for boosting this lending activity, it is very important to have number of lenders present so that people can borrow from them, right? So banks are the traditional lenders. Whenever we think of borrowing some money, one institution that comes to our mind is banks. After that, NBFCs, non-bank finance companies, who are not banks but they are into business of lending, right? So now RBI is saying HFCs can combine with banks. So earlier only NBFCs excluding HFCs were allowed to combine with banks to make loans, but now they have allowed housing finance companies to combine with banks and provide loans to borrowers. So what benefit do you think it is going to provide to both of the parties involved? Here we are going to discuss it from every perspective. First of all, see, banks, what benefit is going to be here for bank? since these housing finance companies, they provide housing loans. They provide loans to people who want to buy house. So they want to buy house. That means these companies have expertise in this real estate sector, which banks might or might not have, because they are not specialized in that field, in housing field or in the real estate field. So HFCs, they are experts of their field, and they might help banks by providing their expertise. Also, these companies, these HFCs, they work on a more local level as compared to big banks, right? So it is easy for them to connect to people because they work on niche level, they work on lower segment. Or you can say that since they have a limited area of work, they are more focused on it. Whereas banks, big banks especially, they are huge in size, so they cannot focus on smaller level of customers. So that is why they both are trying to combine their expertise. So banks, what is the benefit to HFCs? So it is very difficult for NBFCs or HFCs to raise money so that they can on-lend. But for banks, it is relatively easier. So banks might provide their funding expertise because it is easier to raise loans by banks at lower cost, and they, HFCs, might provide their expertise of the segment or niche segment, right? So beneficial, their synergies are going to be combined, right? After that, it is going to be beneficial to borrower also, because they are getting both the benefits in a single deal. And see, this allowance to HFCs is one major step to boost the real estate sector, which is badly crumbling due to the after effects of outbreak of the virus, right? So I hope you understand this. What is a co-lending model? Where different lenders come together and lend or carry on their activities, right? So RBI has called this a co-lending or co-origination of loans model. Here you can see. Okay. So RBI on October 9 came up with co-origination model. Non-bank lenders, including HFCs, allowed to combine with banks, right? So in 2018, RBI had put up a framework for co-origination, but then only NBFCs were allowed, not HFCs, right? Not all. And now it has been made, it has been allowed for all NBFCs, including HFCs. So co-lending provides a unique opportunity for formal lenders to come together and share their synergies, right? NBFCs and HFCs can leverage their strong presence in local market. Commercial bank have the availability of funds. Like we just discussed, NBFCs, they use a number of innovative mechanisms. So you, many a times, these young companies which are working in the finance sector, like HFCs, they are more innovative, or they are, since they have a limited workspace, they are more driven with technology, right, as compared to very big banks. So co-lending enables both the partners to price their portions of the loan. So both are going to decide the terms and conditions of their part of loan. So it might be possible, if a customer is coming to them, 75% loan is being provided by HFC and rest 25% is being provided by a big bank, right? It can be opposite also, right? Moving ahead. So here is your third question, which says, have a look at the following statements about SDLs. Select the ones which are not right. Simple question talking about SDLs, to select the incorrect statement. Moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the solution says that the correct option is option C. That means only one is incorrect, two and three are correct. So first of all, understanding what is STL, State Development Loans. So as you can guess from its name, that these loans are meant for developing states. So guys, just forget this for a minute and let's talk about central government. Whenever central government, they need money, what do? They issue securities, they issue bonds, right, which we usually call treasury bills. So treasury bills or cash management bills for emergency purposes, cash management bills and they issue long term securities also, which are called dated securities. So if you remember, we have discussed these type of securities issued by central government in one of our previous session, in which we discussed treasury bills, cash management bills and dated securities. So if you're not aware of it, you can ask for that video's link, right? To long story short, treasury bills are short term securities issued by central government. Cash management bills to cover the emergency mismatches, and dated securities are the long term, right? But now if we come to states are not allowed to issue short term securities. They only issue dated securities or long term securities, which are called state development loans. So these state development loans, they are nothing but money raised by state governments for long term, right? So I hope there is no doubt about it. That is why the first statement is not right, because they are not issued for short term, they are issued for long term. SDLs are issued by state government, correct option. Eligible for SLR and LAF facilities. So if a bank or an institution, they hold these SDL securities, so states also issue bond to raise money, right? So these loans are taken by issuing securities. SDLs are the loans against which securities are issued by government, state governments. So if any bank is holding these SDLs, they can use it for SLR, that is statutory liquidity ratio, and LAF facilities. So these are facilities provided by RBI to banks so that they can raise money, right? So these STLs can be used for as collateral by banks to avail funding from RBI, right? So now why are we talking about state development loans? Because we are going to discuss some measures which RBI has come up with on October 9, right? One of them deals with STLs. Here you can see it has been decided to conduct open market operations in SDLs as a special case during current financial year. So guys, I hope all of you remember what is the meaning of open market operations. Open market operation means when central government, they sell or buy securities, they either sell or buy government bonds in order to twist their yield, or in order to manipulate the yield which is provided by these securities in their own favor. So if they want to increase it or if they want to decrease it, so in order to manipulate it, open market operations is the process used by central bank, which comprises of selling and buying of securities. So earlier, treasury bills usually were being sold and bought by central bank, but now they are also going to conduct OMOs for STLs. So what benefit it would provide? They are trying to reduce the yields for SDLs. That means they want to lower the cost of borrowings for state government. So if state government, they want to borrow from markets, they have to pay a lower yield or a lower return. So this is one measure brought up by RBI. So it has been decided to extend the dispensation of HTM limits of 22%. So guys, if you remember, we discussed this benefit which RBI came up with earlier. It has been extended, as you can see here, up to March 31, 2022, right? So we have discussed this in one of the video. If you want the link of it, you can comment on the video. So after that, it has been, so guys, we are just trying to run through these measures in brief, because the concepts involved have been previously discussed. So if you are unaware of any of the concept, you can always comment on the video, right? After that, next measure that RBI has come up with, decided to conduct an on-tap TLTRO. So I hope you remember what is TLTRO, targeted long-term repo operations. So on-tap means which are very quick and swift, which can be availed easily, right? So they are going to conduct some quick TLTROs so that they infuse some liquidity into the economy of an amount up to 1 crore. LTRO has been discussed in detail. After that, to reduce licensing uncertainties. Okay, we are going to discuss this point after some more questions, right? Moving ahead to other measures. Here you can see RBI permitted banks to lend up to 7.5 crore to individual retail and small businesses borrowers and still be eligible for a 75% weight norm. Okay, guys, see, you know, whenever banks, they lend to any borrower, they have to assign some risk to it. So if they are lending to a borrower who is very credit worthy, the risk weight is less. But if they are lending to a borrower who is less credit worthy or who has a bad image, then the risk weight is going to be high. Now, earlier what used to happen was banks were allowed to use a 75% risk weight if they were lending till 5 crore. Right, so this was the limit, that if they were lending up to 5 crores to small businesses and individual retail borrowers, then they would mark it as 75% risk weight. And if they go above this, if they lend more than 5 crores, then the risk weight would also increase. Now, why is this not a good thing for bank? Because as the risk weight increases, banks have to make more provisions against it. So the higher the risk weight, the less credit worthy their borrower is, the more provisions they have to make. So the more profits they have to set aside as a provision, right? So now they have extended this limit up to 7.5 crores without increasing the risk weight. That means if they lend up to 7.5 crores, they are going to use 75% as the risk weight, right? So this is an incentive for banks to lend more. Okay, after that, it has been decided to rationalize the risk weights by linking them only with LTV values. So guys, in a recent session, we discussed the meaning of LTV, that is loan to value ratio. For all new housing loans sanctioned up to March 31, 2022. Okay, so now what used to happen was, whenever any borrower comes to bank for loan, let's say I'm a borrower, I want to buy a new car, and I go to a bank and ask them, okay, give me a loan. Now they will ask me, ma'am, how much percent of loan you want. Let's say I want to buy a car which is priced at rupees 10 lakh. So let's say I have 2 lakh in my hand. So I want a loan of rupees 8 lakh. That means I want a loan of 80% of the value of the assets. The value of asset or the car that I want to buy is 10 lakh and I want to borrow 80% of it, that is 8 lakh. So if I will borrow up to 80%, then the risk weight for the bank is going to be 35%. And if I borrow more than 8 lakh, that is between 80% to 90%, let's say I have only 1,50,000 in hand and now I want to borrow 8,50,000, right? So now, since I'm borrowing 8,50,000, I'm borrowing 85% of the value of the asset, right? So now the risk weight for bank is going to be higher, that is 50%. So this is LTV, the loan that you want to take as compared to the asset. So LTV is 85%, so the risk weight is 50%. Now, this risk weight, this was determined by two things. First of all, the LTV, because the higher the loan you are taking as compared to value of assets. Okay, you try to compare it now. I am buying a car worth 10 lakh and I am taking, which one is riskier for the bank? Whether I take a loan of 8 lakh or 8,50,000? Obviously 8,50,000, because I am taking more amount as loan here, right? So the higher the LTV, the higher the amount of loan the borrower takes, the riskier it is for the bank, right? So first factor was LTV to determine this risk weight, and after that the other factor was the amount of loan taken, right? As you can see in this above measure, if the amount of loan went above 5 crores, the risk weight was, the risk weight used to be more than 75%. So this was another factor, the amount of loan, the absolute amount of loan. But now RBI is saying that chuck this amount, we are only going to use LTV as a measure to determine the risk weight, right? So this is also an incentive for banks to lend more. Okay, so moving ahead to one more measure that RBI has come up with, which is it has decided to make available RTGS 24/7 at all days in the year. So 24/7 into 365. RTGS, it was not available 24 hours of the day, it was only available for some certain hours, and that too only on the working days of bank, right? But now it has been made available on all days, on all hours, right? I hope we all are clear what is RTGS, real time gross settlement. It has also been discussed in previous sessions, right? And this facility will be made available from December 2020. Moving ahead, okay, here is your fourth question for today, which says automated teller machines set up, owned and operated by non-bank entities are called dash, whereas dash are the ATMs that are used for e-commerce. Simple, you have to tell the types of ATMs. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says that the correct option is option A. Option A means white label ATMs and yellow label ATMs. So the correct option is white and yellow. So guys, there are different type of ATMs. We all use ATMs on a daily basis to collect cash. Here you can see the different type of ATMs. We are going to just run through them quickly. Bank owned ATMs, if the bank itself owns it. White label ATM. An ATM is called a white label ATM when it is being maintained by an NBFC. A non-bank finance company is maintaining an ATM, then it is called a white label ATM. After that, brown label ATM. So if it is maintained by any third party, that means bank, the control is of the bank, right? The owner, the control is of the bank, but banks have outsourced the activity of maintaining the ATM, then it is called a brown label ATM, right? Here in white, the ownership lies with the NBFC, and in brown, the ownership lies with the bank, but they have outsourced it to a third party to maintain the ATM, right? After that, green label ATM, if it is used for any transaction related to agriculture. Orange label ATM, provided for the purposes of share transactions. So all those ATMs which helps in transacting shares. Pink label ATM, if it is specially made for women, so that women can easily access these services. So they are more guarded so that it is safer for women to access these facilities. Yellow label, if used for the purpose of e-commerce. Mobile ATM, ATM on wheels, if they are not at a fixed location, they change their positions, then it is a mobile ATM. On-site ATM, located within the premises of bank, if it is located inside the bank. Off-site, not located in the bank, so located outside of the bank premises. Worksite ATM, located in the work area of the bank, in the premises of organization, majorly meant for employee use, right? So different types of ATM. Moving ahead, okay, so why we are discussing these ATMs? So guys, here you can see many a times, we just discussed about white label ATMs, right? White label ATMs where it is owned and managed by NBFCs. So for opening a white label ATM, and an organization has to take license from RBI, right? They cannot do it without taking any without taking permission from RBI. They have to take a license. So earlier these licenses, these permissions were provided for a limited amount of time, but and it they had to be renewed after some after the interval or after the tenure of the license. But now RBI is saying let us provide them license for a perpetual period so that we do not have to renew it again, because there are many regulatory resources. These companies also have to spend some money, time and effort on renewing the license. So let us provide them with a perpetual license. So this was the last measure. This was one measure that we skipped here. Here you can see reduce licensing uncertainties to enable PSOs, that means payment service operators, all the companies which are in the business of facilitating payment somehow are known as PSOs, to focus on their business and optimize utilization so that they do not waste their resources on renewing the license. So it has been decided to grant authorization for all PSOs for both. So there can be prepaid payment instruments as well. We have discussed PPIs in one of the sessions, who take license from the RBI. So on a perpetual basis, subject to certain conditions, although they have to follow some conditions if they want this perpetual license, right? So moving ahead to the last question for today, and here is the last question, which says RBI has recently revised the rules regarding export data processing and monetary system. According to that, an exporter would be caution listed by RBI based on the recommendations of dash concerned. So you have to fill in the blank. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says that the correct option is option A. Option A means authorized dealer bank. So let us first try to understand the meaning of export data processing and monetary system. So what is this EDPMS? So guys, this EDPMS, what is it? See, this is a system, or you can see this is a mechanism which was provided to facilitate exporters so that they can carry out their transactions easily. As you can see here, an online system launched by RBI in 2014 for monitoring all export activities in India too, so that they can control all export activities, right? So now according to this system EDPMS, what used to happen was, if any exporter whose payments were due, they were put into a list, they were caution listed automatically. That means they were put into a separate list so that reminders could be sent to them that okay, your payment is pending, and make that payment, fulfill that obligation, right? So if any shipping bill against them remained outstanding for more than 2 years, if they didn't pay for 2 years, then they were automatically added to this caution list, provided no extension was granted for fulfilling this payment. And apart from this, okay, one condition of is of 2 years, no payment for 2 years, then that exporter is going to be put into caution list. Apart from that, if any authorized dealer bank means a bank which has been permitted by regulatory authorities to deal in foreign exchange, probably a bank which is dealing with this exporter. So if an authorized dealer bank told regulatory authorities about an exporter that this particular exporter does not have a good track record, they could also be put into caution list before the expiry of 2 years, if any authorized dealer advised it or recommended it. So two conditions that they were followed under this system. Now, in order to make the system more exporter friendly, it has been decided to discontinue this automatic caution listing. So there was also a clause for automatic delisting from the caution list, that if any exporter made payment, fulfilled payment, then automatically they were delisted, right? So in order to make the system more exporter friendly and equitable, decided to discontinue the automatic caution listing. So RBI will continue with caution listing based on case specific recommendations of the AD bank. So now this automatic system is going to be cancelled, that 2 years condition, and only and a caution list would be prepared, or an exporter would be put into a caution list only when an AD bank recommends it, right? So automatic system has been discontinued, right? So this is one more measure that that RBI has come up with. So this is just to make the system more the system easier for exporters, so they are not automatically blacklisted, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today, and if you noticed, leaving question number 1, question 2, 3, 4 and 5, they were related to the measures that RBI came up recently on Friday, came up with, right? So I hope now you are clear with all the measures. Some forecast and some other news about these measures, some other parts of these measures were covered by Neha ma'am in her session, right? So we are, before ending the session, we are going to discuss one article that was asked by one of you, and this article is called Big Borrowers Need Relief as Well, which was into ET recently, right? So guys, if you remember, we discussed that how government was into favor of waiving the interest for small borrowers below the threshold of 2 crores, and government said, okay, we are going to compensate banks for that interest, do not collect interest from small borrowers, right? So this article talks about an issue of large borrowers. So they are saying that here government is providing a benefit, or government is taking the responsibility to compensate the banks, but the point is, what about the borrowers who are above the threshold of 2 crores? They also need relief as well, because they are systemically very important for the economy, right? So they also need relief. That is why the article is called Big Borrowers Need Relief as Well. So I hope, so basically this article talks about how this relief provided by government is not complete unless and until they provide some benefit to the large borrowers, or they do something for them also. Just leaving them aside or leaving them on their own does not make any sense, or does not complete the help, right? So I hope now you are clear with this article. So guys, this is it for today, and I hope you learned something new from this video. If you did, then don't forget to give us a thumbs up. I'll be back in the next session with some new information. Until then, you take care of yourself, study hard, and see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.